A very good afternoon to all of you. I will be very shortly starting with my session. So I can see many participants are joining in. I'll wait for another minute and I'll start. I hope the audio and the video both are visible to all of you. Okay, so let's start. A very good afternoon to all of you. I, Dr. Tanya Bose, welcome you all to the third session of FDP on LaTeX, an art of writing research manuscript. So far, I have discussed with you basic document creation, various text formatting options, how to insert graphics, and how to insert or construct tables within your document. So we have to keep in mind all these commands while we proceed further for the future sessions, as at the end day, that is tomorrow, I will tell you how to write a research paper. So these are all the prerequisites required, right? So every day keep on revising the lectures. So now let me begin with my third session. Okay. So today, the outline of my presentation would be mathematical typesetting, and the second section would focus on reference management, right? So let's begin with the first session, mathematical typesetting. Now, how do we write mathematical formula in LaTeX? So if we write the mathematical formula like we were writing the text, it will always give you an error. So whenever you're going to write a formula in your paragraph or in anywhere in your document, you always have to surround them with a dollar sign, right? So suppose you want to write x plus y. So you have to write a dollar at the beginning of the statement and you have to write a dollar at the end of the statement. So let me show you an example. I want to write the Greek alphabet alpha. So how am I going to write it? For alpha, I have to, since alpha will not be written as such, I have to give the command backslash alpha. So when I give the command backslash alpha, it will recognize it as a Greek character and I have to enclose it with a dollar sign. So when I check the output of this text source, I will get my output in this form. If I simply write alpha without writing the backslash, it will only type the letters A, L, P, H, A. That's it, right? So whenever we are going to write anything related to maths, it has to be always enclosed with the dollar sign. So let's take a look at all the Greek letters that are available in LaTeX. So it is very user-friendly. So the way we call that Greek letter, same as the command. So for generating alpha, we have to write backslash alpha. For beta, the command goes as backslash beta, gamma is backslash gamma, and you can check on all these Greek letters, delta, epsilon, zeta, eta, theta, iota, kappa, lambda, mu, nu, xi, pi, rho, sigma, tau, phi, chi, psi, omega, gamma, delta, theta, lambda, capital pi, capital sigma, capital phi, and capital psi. So it's not necessary that only the students who have maths background, only they require Greek letters. It can be used in any field, right? Okay. So we move on with the next topic, that is how to write exponents in LaTeX. Now suppose I want to write x to the power 2. So whenever I want to write an exponent, we use the caret character that is available on your keyboard at the numeric key 6, right? So we use the caret character to write exponents. So let us see how to write it. Since it is again a mathematical symbol, we will always enclose it in dollar signs and we will write x caret 2. So when I execute it, I will get my output as x square, right? Likewise, suppose I want to write x raised to power 21, then what is to be done? Check this text source. I have written x raised to power 21. This means backslash NE means not equal to. So I told you in the beginning that LaTeX is very user friendly. The way we call the commands, the same way the syntax is also available. So not equal to means backslash NE. And then I have written X caret symbol and I've enclosed 21 in curly braces. Now, what is the difference in the output of X to the power 21 and X to the power braces 21? Let's check the output. So if I write x to the power 21 as such, it will only understand that I want to put 2 in the exponent. 1 will be written as such. So you can see that the output is in this way. But if I enclose 21 in braces, it understands that I have to raise 21 to the exponent. The entire 21 term is to be raised to the exponent. That means whenever we are taking exponent of only one character, you can avoid the braces symbol. But if I want a group of characters to be written in the exponent, that group of characters have to be always put in curly braces, right? Okay. Next is subscripts. So for writing superscripts, we use caret symbol. For writing subscripts, we have to use the same way we are writing for exponents or superscripts. But in place of caret, we will use the underscore symbol, right? So let's look at this example. I'm writing, and the same technique is available here also. So we write x underscore 21 not equal to x underscore curly braces 21. So how will the output show me? Output tells me that x underscore 2. So it will only take 2 to the subscript. And 1 will be written as such. And x underscore 21, when I write it in curly braces, it understands that I have to put 21 in the subscript, right? So the same rule follows here. Any group of characters, if it has to be written in subscript, we will enclose them in curly braces. But if there is only one character that is to be written in subscript, you can avoid the curly braces. Even if you write the curly braces, it will give you the same output, right? Okay. Next is how to write fractions in LaTeX. Now there are two ways of writing fractions in LaTeX. One is a diagonal way and the second one is a horizontal way. I'll show you both the ways, right? Now, diagonal fraction, it works best when you're writing the fraction in a tight space, right? So let us look at this example. I've written dollar sign A. Now, this is not backslash, this is front slash, right? So whenever I write a backslash, it takes it as a command. But now I'm using for fraction as the front slash symbol. So A front slash B. So when I check the output, I get my output in this form. So this is the type of diagonal fraction. Now let me check how to write horizontal fraction. Horizontal fraction, it's written like this, numerator over denominator, right? This is how we start from the very beginning, from the very junior classes when we study about fractions, right? How to write it? The syntax is, again, everything is enclosed in dollars. And then how do we write it? Since it's a fraction, we use the command backslash frac. In curly braces, we first write the numerator part. And in the second curly braces, we write the denominator part. So if I want to write x upon y, I will write backslash frac. Then I will write x here. And then I will write y here. Right? Let me show you this in a LaTeX editor. Let me share my screen first. Okay. So in this LaTeX editor, whatsoever we have learned so far, let me show you how it executes here. Okay. So let me write an exponent term. So I have to enclose. Okay. Let me write first x to the power 2. See, it's a max character. And if I don't put dollars, what happens? Let me see. Let me execute it. See, at the end, it is showing me missing dollar inserted x to the power. So it is showing me an error. Whenever you get a red highlight, that means there's an error. Now let me enclose this in dollar sign and let me execute it. So I guess you can see the output. It is written as x square, right? Okay. Let me convert it to the next line so that it is visible to all of you. So you can see it is written as x square, right? Likewise, for a new line, if you remember, I have to put two backslashes. Okay, now let me write x to the power y plus z. So I will write x to the power. I have to write y plus z. So it is a group of characters. I'll enclose this in curly braces and I will write y plus z. Let me execute it. Can you see? It is written x to the power y plus z, right? Likewise, for subscript, we have seen how to write it. Suppose I want to write x to the power, okay, x, and in subscript, I want to write, say, 1, 2. So I will write underscore, I will put it in curly braces, and I can write underscore, right? So I get x subscript 1, 2. So if you want to write a single character, you can write it like this, x underscore 1. So it will be written as x 1. Even if I put a curly brace here, it will give me the same answer. So for writing just a single character, you can avoid also and you can write also. It's your choice, right? Now let's see how to write fractions. So to write a diagonal fraction, I will just write a front slash b. So I can check my output. So I will see that it is written as a slash b. Likewise, to write a horizontal fraction, suppose I want to write x upon y plus z. So how will I write it? First of all, dollars. Then I will write backslash frac for fraction. Numerator is x. I will enclose it in curly braces. In the second curly braces, I will write y plus z. When I execute it, I'll get my answer as x upon y plus z, right? So I think so far it is clear to you. Okay. So I'm getting a question here. That is exponent same as superscript? Yes, exponent is same as superscript, right? Okay. Now, let me go back to the slides. Okay. So till here, I think it is clear to everybody how to write superscript, how to write subscript, and how to write fractions. Next is about the trigonometric functions. Now, how will you make LaTeX understand that suppose you want to talk about sine of any angle? How will you make LaTeX understand that sine is a trigonometric function and it is not a product of simply the three characters sin? So we will always put a backslash in front of it to make it understand that this is a command. It is not a group of simple variables sin. So we use these as the trigonometric functions. So you can see all these trigonometric functions and along with some other functions. To use sine of an angle, we will write backslash sine. The angle will be written along with it. For cosine of an angle, we write backslash cos. To calculate the argument, we write arg. For calculating inverse trigonometric functions, we will write arc tan for tan inverse, arc sine for sine inverse, arc cos for cos inverse. For hyperbolic functions, the formulas are cos h, sine h, tan h. Then cot is again another trigonometric function. Cosecant is again another trigonometric function. Then to calculate determinant, we have DET symbol. Then GCD is for greatest common divisor, limit of a function. Then infimum of a function. So all these commands we can use while we are working in LaTeX, right? Okay. Now let's talk about summation and integrals. How to write summation and how to write integrals. Now for summations, you have always seen that there is always a lower limit and an upper limit. So what is the text source behind it? Let me show you the summation first. So a summation is always written like this, I is equal to 0 to n. So what is the text source? How will I write it? I will first of all enclose it in dollars. Then I will write, since it is sum, so I will write backslash sum. Since this is written in the subscript, so I will use the underscore symbol. For underscore, subscript is written. What is in the subscript? I is equal to 0. So I will enclose I is equal to 0 because it is a group of characters. I will enclose it in curly braces. And now if you look at n, what is n? N is an exponent or it is a superscript. So I will write caret and then I will write n, right? So we are using the previous knowledge only. So for summation, the command is backslash sum. For I equal to 0, since it is written in the subscript, I am using the symbol underscore and I'm writing I equal to 0 in curly braces. And then I can see that n is a exponent or it is a superscript. So I'm writing it in caret n, right? Likewise, integrals also have a lower and an upper limit when we talk about the definite integrals. So how to write it? So look at this definite integral. It is simply integration a to b. So I will again enclose it in curly brace, sorry, in dollars. Then I will, for integration, I will use the command backslash int. And then again, I can see that a is the subscript and b is the superscript. So underscore a will show that this is the subscript and caret b will show that this is the superscript, right? So when I write this in the text source, I will get this as my output, right? Okay. Next is how to write limits. The same way we are going to write limits also. Look at the limit output. Suppose I need to write limit x approaches to 0 or suppose any other number here. So again, it is enclosed in dollar signs. Then for limit, we will use the symbol command backslash lim. Then you can see that x approaching to 0 is written in the subscript. So for subscript, we will use the underscore symbol. And this entire thing is written in the subscript. So it will be enclosed in curly braces. And then we will write x. This is a write words arrow. So this will have the command write backslash write arrow. And it is approaching to 0. So 0 will be written here, right? When we execute this command, you will get the output as, sorry, you will get the output as limit x approaches to 0, right? Okay. So I hope how to write summation, integrals, and limits are clear to you. So it is using the previous knowledge of writing how to write exponents and subscript. And for summation, the command is backslash sum. For integrals, the command is backslash int. For limits, the command is backslash lim, right? Okay. Now, let's move on to how to write square roots. Now, for writing square roots, we have the command backslash sqrt, and whatever you need to write within the square root, that has to be enclosed in curly braces, right? Let's look at the text source. I have written in dollar sign, square root first, backslash sqrt. Then what is to be written in square root is enclosed in curly braces. And what text do I want to write? I'm writing backslash frac ab. So this was for fraction, horizontal fraction. So my output will be shown as under root a upon b, right? Okay. So similarly, we also have a command for nth root. To calculate the nth square root, what do we write? We write, again, it is written in dollars. We write square root. Since nth root, this is the option. Otherwise, we normally work with square root. So the option is always written in a box brackets. So So we will write a box bracket and we will write which nth root we want to calculate, and we will write it over here. And likewise, the same thing, we will enclose it in curly braces, and whatever we want to write within the curly braces, that will be shown in the square root symbol. So you can check the output that this is written in the output, right? Okay, let me show you this in the LaTeX editor. Let me share my screen with you first. Okay, so let's come back here. Let me delete all these parts. Okay. Now, let me write square root first. So SQRT, and suppose I want to write 24. So when I check my output, I will get square root 24, right? Okay. Now suppose I want to write, let me write something in integral, int limits from a to b. Okay. And then I write x by y. So you can see this. This is how integrals work, right? Okay. So let me go back to the screen. Okay. Next is, what about the different accents? So how LaTeX works with it? So to write this symbol, we use the symbol, it is a hat. So it is acute a. So backslash acute. Then to write in this way, we use the command backslash grave. To write a, and there is a tilde sign there. So the command is backslash tilde. Then to write a bar, we will write backslash bar, and whatever you want to write, you have to enclose it in curly braces. Then to write a vector, we will write vec a. Then to write hat, we will write hat a. Similarly, this is the check symbol. So this is check a dot and a double dot. So we have d dot, right? So you can see it is very user friendly. So since I call this bar, so the command is also bar. This is called vector, so the command is also vector. This is the grave symbol, so this is also the grave command. So the way you call the symbols, the same way the commands are also designed, right? Okay. So a dot and a double dot are used for single differentiation and double differentiation. Okay. Then is bracketed symbols. Now you might have seen that suppose we write a group of expressions, then in that case, if I just put my small brackets, then the group of expressions are not completely enclosed within the braces. So I have to put a longer brace for that. So if I want to match the size of my braces with the expression, how to write it, right? So for that, suppose these three dots are my expressions that I want to write, and it is a long expression. I want to match the size of the brace with my expression. So before the expression starts, I have to write whichever bracket I want to write. I will put that bracket. And in front of that bracket, I have to give the command backslash left. And as soon as my expression finishes, I have to write backslash right. And then I will close the bracket, right? So if I omit left and right, and I simply put round brackets, the size of my expression will not match the size of the brackets. So to match the size, I have to write backslash left in the beginning, and I have to write backslash right at the end. Let me show you an example. So let me talk about dots, and I'll show you that example. Now, what are dots? Now, the continuation dots, they are known as ellipses. Now, there are various kinds of ellipses while we work in LaTeX. What are all those? We have C dots for center height dots. We have D dots for diagonal dots. We have L dots for lower height dots. And we have V dots for vertical dots. So C will represent center, D will represent diagonal, L will represent lower, and we will represent vertically. And we have dots common to all, right? Let me show you the output first. Suppose the text is written as A1, comma. You can see an ellipse has been written here. And we have AN. Can you yourself see what is the alignment of your dots? Out of these four dots, which one it should be? So it is lower height dots. They are placed at the lower end. So they are lower height dots. So how will I write my text source? See, I am first of all enclosing it in dollars. Then A1, what is 1? It is a subscript. So I will write A_1. Then I'll put a comma. Then I will write \L. Then I will put a comma. And then I will write A_N. Right? So when I execute it, I will get this as my output. Right? Okay. Now, next is talking about arrays. Now, the previous slide that I was talking about, left and right commands, the bracket symbols, they are mainly used in arrays. Now, what are arrays? Arrays are basically constructed the same way we did tables yesterday. If you remember my yesterday's session, in tables, what was the environment used? We used begin tabular and we used the command end tabular, right? And there was justification written here. So array also works in the same way. So instead of tabular, we will give the command array. Likewise, in justification, your text can be aligned towards the left, towards the center, or towards the right. So for left justification, we will use L. For center justification, we will use C. And for right justification, we will use R. Then for the body of the array, to separate the column entries, we will use the symbol AND. We did it yesterday the same way. And then for a new line, we will write \ at the end. And since array is a group of expressions, so if you want, suppose you want to write a matrix, so you have to match the brackets with the expressions, right? So we will write, we will enclose the array here. And before the array begins, we will write \left brackets. And when it ends, we will write \right, and then we will put a bracket, right? Let me show you a text source here. You can check that this is a matrix, right? How will I write this matrix in LaTeX? Look at the text source. It is starting with a dollar sign. It is ending with a dollar sign, right? Then you can see that the group of expression and the height of this bracket is matching. So that is why I have started with a left bracket. So you can see that I've written \left and I'm opening the bracket. And at the end, I'm writing \right and I'm closing the bracket. And in between, I'm going to write the body of my text. Now this is an array. So I'm giving it an array environment. So I'm writing begin array and I'm ending it as end array, right? Now, along with begin array, I have to give the justification of my text. So you can see they are center aligned. So I'm writing CCC, right? And then looking at the first row elements, the first row tell me it is A11. Both 1 and 1, they are at the subscript position. So I'm writing it as A_11 in curly braces. Then I have to separate my next column entry. So I'm putting an AND symbol here. And then if you look at these three ellipses, which kind of ellipse is this? Look at the alignment. Can you see they are placed at the center? So it is a centered dot. So I'm writing \C. Then I have to separate my next column entry. So I'm putting an AND symbol here. And my next entry is A1N. So I'm writing A_1 and N has been enclosed in curly braces, right? Then I want that the LaTeX should understand that I finished with my first row entries. I have to go to the next row. So I'm putting a \ option here, right? Okay, now let's go back to the output. Look at the next row. Which type of dots are these? These are vertical dots, right? So my first entry is V_. Then I'm putting an AND symbol. Then look at this alignment. This is in the form of a diagonal. So I'm writing D_ for that. And then finally, the last one is again vertical dots. So I'm writing V dots. Then again, I put a double backslash command. Then I move on to my last row. It is A underscore M1. And now again, which type of dots are these? These are center height dots. So I'm writing C dots for it. And again, and A underscore MN. And then I've ended my array, and then I've ended my brackets also. So when I check the text source, when I execute this, I will get my output in this way, right? Okay. Yes, there is one question that will V dots always represent three dots? Yes, whenever you are expressing a group of dots, always three dots are represent, not more than three dots, right? Okay. Now let me show you this in the text editor. I will show you if I don't put left and right command, what happens then, right? Let me go back to my text editor and show you this. Okay. Let me quickly write down the array first. Okay. So I'm writing begin array. And I'm writing, I'm just writing two columns, right? And then I'm ending it, end array. And in between, let me write as one and two. And the next line is 3 and 4. Okay. Now let me execute it. Okay. I have an inserted and dollar sign here, so you can see that there is an error. Let me insert the dollar symbol here. Okay. Can you see the output? What is the difference? Can you see that here I haven't matched my brackets? I didn't write left and right here. So you can see that if I write a group of expressions, the bracket, if I just put a simple bracket, it is not matching the group of expressions, right? But the moment if I write here left and I write here right, what happens? Let me zoom in this. Can you see that the brackets has been matched with the group of expressions, right? Likewise, I can put any type of bracket here. I can put a square bracket, right? And I can end it with a square bracket. So when I put a square bracket, the brackets will be changed, right? So this was just the meaning of why we are writing left and right in the beginning and at the end of the bracket, right? Okay. So I hope you got a better understanding now. Okay. Let me go back to my slides. So dots and arrays, I hope they are clear now. Okay. Next is how to write equations. Now, whichever background we have, these days equations are must. Whether you write one equation, two equations, but they are required in your research paper. So to how to write equations. Now, when we write equations in Microsoft Word, it becomes very tiring job in the editor when you write the equations, right? And then you have to typeset all the equations properly. Now, how to write it in LaTeX? So again, equation requires an environment, and that environment is at the beginning of the equation, we have to write begin equation, and at the end, we have to write end equation, right? And another important difference between writing equations in LaTeX and writing equations in Microsoft Word. In Microsoft Word, when you're writing the equations, you have to number them yourselves. isn't it? And suppose you forget to write an equation in between, and if you again insert that equation, you have to manually change all the numbers after that. But in LaTeX, whenever you use this environment, begin equation and end equation, the numbers are automatically made with the help of LaTeX, right? Like if you remember when we were organizing our data into different sections, we were never writing the section number along with it. The section numbers were automatically marked with the help of LaTeX, right? The same way in equations also, the numbers are marked accordingly in LaTeX. And again, if you change any equation, the equation number will automatically get changed, right? Even if you refer to some equation within the text, even that number will change automatically, right? Okay. Now, suppose if you don't want any particular equation to be given a number, then what is the environment used? We will use the environment equation star. The same thing we were using in section also. If you want that LaTeX should mark all the sections automatically, we use the environment / section. But if I don't want any section to be given a number, then we use the command section star. Likewise, in equations also, if I don't want that this equation should be numbered, I will write begin equation star. And same way, I will end it up as end equation star, right? Okay. Now, look at this text source. I have written the two equations in two different ways. You can see that there is some text written here, and in between the text, I'm writing an equation and I'm not giving it any number. And then I'm again writing another equation and I'm giving it a particular number, right? Now, if I want to write an equation within my text and I don't want to put a number in it, how to write it? And if I'm writing an equation like this, I'm just specifying that equation separately and I wanted a number, how to write it? Let's check the output. So mathematical formulae may appear as inline formulae such as, so when I want to write an equation within the text, I can enclose it in dollar symbols, right? So I've written, like I wanted to write a plus b whole square. So I'm writing a plus b in round brackets, and then I'm writing exponent 2 equal to is written as such. Then I'm writing a square. So it is a exponent 2 plus b exponent 2 plus 2ab. So when I execute this, I will get my output in this way, right? And suppose I want that LaTeX should mark this equation a particular number, then what to do? I will write it in an environment, begin equation and end equation. So I've written the same equation, but I have enclosed it with an environment. And that environment is begin equation and end equation, right? So when I give this as my text source, automatically LaTeX will give it a number, and that number will appear as 1, right? Okay. Let me show you this in the LaTeX editor so that it becomes clear to you. Okay, let's see. Let me just quickly rub this off. Okay, let me write that. Suppose with this text, I want to write an expression. X plus Y is equal to Z. So I'm writing X plus Y is equal to Z. Let me execute it. So you can see that very easily it has been written here, right? And you can see that the format of the max equation is written in a different way, right? Okay. Now, let me write another equation and I want to give it a number. So I have to give the environment begin equation. Okay, I haven't written / begin equation, and I will write end equation. And then let me write my equation here. Let me write a to the power 2 plus b to the power 2 plus 2ab is equal to a plus b to the power 2. Let me execute it. Okay. Can you see that it has been given a number 1, right? Now, suppose I want to write another equation. Let me copy this down. And let me change the variables. Let me make it X and Y. Okay. Okay, so done. Let me execute it. Can you see that it has been marked as number 2? I am not giving 1 and 2 anywhere, right? So if I change their positions, let me change their positions. Let me put this equation here. And now let me execute it. Can you see automatically this equation was given 1 and this equation is given 2, right? Okay. Okay. Fine. So I hope this is clear to everybody. Okay. Next, let me go back to my slides. Okay. There is a quick question for you all. And the question says, just quickly mark your option. Okay, so let me close the question here. So most of you have answered it correctly. It is the first one, that is dollars. Okay. And the second question is, okay, let me close the question. Yes, to automatically number the equations, you have to use an environment, and that is begin equation and end equation, right? Okay, so there is a question from the audience also that if you want to write the equation numbers in square brackets, what is to be done? Now, in the basic LaTeX editor page, you have to write the equations in this way only. So if you have to write it in another way, you have to use some packages for it. And nowadays, when we are sending our papers to journals, they provide already with a LaTeX template. So I will talk about to you in my last lecture, that is tomorrow. So I will let you know how do we put our document in that template, right? So just wait for tomorrow's session. Okay. So let me go back to my presentation. And with this, our first section ends, that is mathematical typesetting, and we move on to the last section, that is reference management. Now, what is reference management? Now, you can see this is a screenshot of a text where I've written some text, and you can see that within the text, some references are already cited. The citations are done in this way, 1 and 2. And the references 1 and 2 are given, right? Now, how do we write all this thing in LaTeX? It's very simple. So you can see how do we write. Let me show you the editor, the input for the references. So first of all, the basic thing is we write document class article. To start with the document, we have to enclose it with the environment begin document and end document. And then this portion of the text is simply typed. I've written the requirements of lightweight, so on till dynamic system. Just forget about these two things. I'll tell you a bit just now. Then how to write the references. For references, the environment used is begin the bibliography, and we have to end the bibliography, right? So you have to use the environment the bibliography. And then along with that, you have to write any random number here. It's not necessary that you have to write 10. You just have to write a number. That's it. If you don't write this in curly braces, it will give you an error. So you have to just write a random number here. It can be one, it can be any number, right? Okay. Then how do we start writing our references? So look at the first reference. This is my first reference. Again, automatically all these numberings, they are done with the help of LaTeX. We don't have to number them, right? So you can see I've written bib item. If you remember my session on bulleted text, we use the environment itemize or enumerate for getting numbered list or bulleted list. And with every line, in the beginning, we used to write / item. So these are also items, but they are bibliography items. So that is why we are writing bib item, right? Just forget about this number, this curly braces. And then you can see that I have written this portion of my text of this reference in the same way like I wanted, right? Now, if you look at this tilde sign, it means I'm putting a space here, right? So this will put a small space between dot and. So wherever I'm using tilde, tilde means it is a small space between these two characters, right? And then if you look at this part, I have mentioned the journal name in italic. I want to mention it in an italic phrase. So I'm enclosing it in curly braces and I'm writing IT. Or there is another way of doing it that I told you yesterday. Before the curly braces, you can write / text IT, right? And then I want to write the volume number and issue number in boldface. So in front of it, I'm writing BF. Yesterday, I told you about boldface. There was another command. In front of the curly braces, you can write text BF, / text BF. So you can use that also, right? Okay, there is a question. Yes, you can do Mendeley also using LaTeX. There is no issue. Mendeley also justifies your all the bibliography items here. And then I'm writing it. And then the second bibliography also I've written it here, right? Now, this is about how to write bibliography. Now, suppose I want to cite my bibliography, the references in my text. Now you can see that here I have cited my first bibliography item. And here I'm citing my second bibliography item. So how is citation done? So if you remember, I told you it in figures also, how to refer the figures in your text. There we used, in the caption, we used to write / label. And in the text, we used to write refer. And then we used to write the same call number. So here, I'm calling my first reference with the name. You can write anything here. You can write 1, 2, 3. You can give any random number here. Random number, random alphabet, anything. So I have used my characters as Bose1. So I'm putting it in curly braces. This is the name of this first bibliography, right? And since I want to refer it here in my text, so for referring, I'm for citing it, I'm writing the command / cite. And the same call number is given to it, right? Similarly, I'm naming my second bibliography item as Bose2. And I want to refer it here. So I'm writing it as cite Bose2, right? So when I check its output, I will get that. I will get my citation as 1 marked here and 2 marked here, right? Let me show you it in LaTeX editor. Let me show you there. Let's go to the reference part. And you can see here, I've written that same text and let me execute it. So you can see that my text appears like this. I was telling you that you can give any number here. Let me change this. Let me write here ABC. So if I'm naming this as ABC, wherever I'm citing it, my text, the same thing should be written, right? So when I write ABC here and when I execute it, you can see that it has been marked as 1 and it has been marked as 1, right? So naming doesn't affect it. You can give 1 here also. So it is your choice how you want to name it, right? So the calling number should be same. Now suppose if I write one here and I'm writing something else here, I'm writing ABC here, right? What it will do? You can see that it is putting a question mark over here, that it is not able to understand the citation that is written. You can see there's a question mark. That means these calling numbers are not same, right? Or it is not able to recognize what is ABC because it is missing in my bibliography, right? So I have to give it the same calling number. I hope this is clear. Okay. Likewise, suppose this is my document. It is in my ready. It is already ready. And somehow I forget to put one reference now, right? So let me show you another example. So after these two already, they were present. I have added one more bibliography item. So I have inserted here and I'm naming it with the symbol A as the, normally how I do, I take the initials of the authors, right? So I have used A, S, Z, and I'm somewhere referring it here. So you can see when I execute it, automatically the numbers have changed. Earlier this was 1 and this was 2. Now this is 1, 2 and 3. And automatically these numbers are also changed. I didn't have to change them here. But the same thing if you were working in Word, you had to change all these numbers also, along with you have to renumber your list, right? So this is the advantage of using LaTeX over Word. Okay. So if you are used, there is one question that if there are 100 references, then we have to mention all one by one separately. Yes, if you are writing in manual mode, you have to write them one by one. But if you are using Mendeley, you can insert them as such, right? Okay. Then, so this was with the reference management section. So this was a screenshot of whatever I explained you just now. And with this, I end my session. So if you have any queries, you can drop your mails to my mail address, tanya.bose@kara.edu.in. And okay, thank you so much. We meet tomorrow at the same time. So my request before we meet tomorrow, because I will be telling you about all your research paper writing. So just revise all the commands so that it becomes easier for us to recall them. That's all. Thank you so much.
That's it.